Hello dear learners, today we are going to talk about thyroxine and antithyroid drugs. From the chapter thyroxine and antithyroid drug, we are going to talk about the subtopic, that is secretion of thyroid hormones. So I will take just a review what we have covered in our last video. We have covered about the synthesis of thyroid hormones. The synthesis of thyroid hormone was up to thyroid glands, what the process was occurring in the thyroid follicle. But when it comes to secretion, the secretion involves how it is released into the bloodstream or how the thyroid hormones are released. So thyroid gland, who sends the messages to thyroid gland from the brain, and how thyroid gland comes to know that we are supposed to start the secretion of thyroid hormones now, synthesis and secretion, or we are supposed to stop the synthesis and secretion of thyroid hormones now. When there is an excess, they will stop the synthesis. When there is a deficiency, they will start the synthesis. So, who controls this or who governs this activity of the thyroid gland? So, we are going to talk about the link between the brain and the thyroid gland. So, as you all know, glands are majorly responsible. As we all know, in our earlier video, we have seen that thyroid gland synthesizes T3 and T4, that is thyroid hormones. So, first we will see the basic introduction to the glands, and then we will go towards the secretion of thyroid hormones, how they are released. So, some glands are exocrine glands. Few of them are endocrine glands, and few glands, for example, you can call like pancreas. This is this acts both way. This is exocrine also and endocrine also. Some are like that, which will act as endocrine glands also, as well as also. So these glands which secretes various hormones, when the imbalance in this hormone level occurs, this leads to some or the other disease or dysfunction. First, we will see what are exocrine glands. So, exocrine glands, as you all might be knowing, these are the glands which secretes their secretions or products, not specifically hormones. They will secrete their products by the way of some duct. As you can see here in the image, I have taken one sweat gland image along with the salivary gland image. So, what happens here, as you can see the final outcome, this is through a pore. The sweat is getting secreted through the sweat gland, and this saliva is getting secreted through the excretory duct. So, exocrine gland secretes their secretions by the way of duct. As you can see here, this is the duct or this pore. So, they need some external duct or pore kind of structures to secrete their secretions in the environment external to them. So, this environment external to them can be either on the surface of their body or it can be inside the body. So, sweat is on the surface, like on the skin. Saliva is inside, that means inside the mouth. So, these are various glands such as sweat glands, salivary glands, mammary glands, pancreas. Now, as we have seen that pancreas is acting as both exocrine as well as endocrine gland. So, exocrine gland is the secretions through the duct to the environment. It can be on the surface or it can be inside the body. And endocrine glands, when it comes to endocrine glands release major hormones, approximately 20 major hormones, and they will release directly into the bloodstream without any duct or any channel or any pore, directly by diffusion mechanism into their surrounding tissues, and they directly affect on the target cell. That means endocrine hormones which are released, they need some receptors which should be present on the target cell from whom they will act. So, the target cells will contain receptors for these various hormones which are secreted by the endocrine gland, and by diffusion only they will go into the surrounding. They don't need any medium such as duct or pore or any channel for their secretion or for the release, you can call. And few of the examples of endocrine glands are, one of the major gland, that is pituitary gland, which is called as the master gland of the endocrine glands. This pituitary gland controls, which is present on the border way of the brain and spinal cord. This controls the activities of various endocrine glands. Then next is parathyroid gland, pancreas, again see, which is acting as both. So I have included this example in both. Then adrenals, ovaries, testes. So as you can see here, I have taken two diagrams. Like this is with respect to the pancreas, and this is the master gland, that is pituitary gland. So this exocrine pancreas, this outer layer you can see, and inside we have alpha cells and beta cells. And you very well know beta cells of isolates of Langerhans of pancreas secretes insulin. These alpha cells, which are there inside this outer layer, secretes glucagon. And this exocrine pancreas secretes various digestive enzymes, which are released into the external environment, or you can call it as GI tract. And this pituitary, as you can see, this anterior region of the pituitary, it secretes various pituitary hormones such as TSH, ACTH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone, adrenocorticotropic hormone, follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, growth hormone, prolactin. So as far as the today's video is concerned, this is important, TSH, which stimulates thyroid gland to produce thyroid or to synthesize thyroid, and which is then released into the bloodstream. So in our earlier video, we have covered that how thyroid follicle synthesizes T3 and T4 and releases it into the bloodstream. But what, when it comes to before the thyroid gland, means what are the processes which we come across, or from where are sent to the thyroid gland? Thyroid hormones, in what case thyroid gland secretes thyroid hormones or stops the secretion of thyroid hormones, all these things we will see in the feedback loop in our next video. But in today's video, we are going to talk about the secretion from brain, who sends the signal and where it stops and how it secretes. The other secretions are, see, prolactin from mammary gland, growth hormone acting on the entire body, FSH and LH, these are from the ovaries or testes, adrenocorticotropic hormone is from adrenal cortex. So TSH to thyroid, which is controlled by pituitary and which in turn is controlled by hypothalamus. So how it is controlled by pituitary and hypothalamus, or how hypothalamus sends the signal to the pituitary and how pituitary passes it to the thyroid glands, we will see in today's video. Now see, these are few of the important endocrine glands pictorically represented. These glands which we are seeing right now in this chapter is thyroid gland, parathyroid gland, then adrenal gland, pancreas are there, testes is there, ovaries are there. So all these glands secretes one or the other hormone, and these are controlled by these two major organs, you can call, or two major region in the brain, which is hypothalamus. Hypothalamus controls pituitary gland, and pituitary gland is which is acting as the master gland, is responsible for secretion of many different hormones. And by itself also, as well as along with producing itself, it is acting, or it is targeting the other glands also and making them also to secrete the hormones. So coming towards the next, this overview, I will just take a overview through this diagram of the synthesis of thyroid hormones, and then we will go to the actual secretion part. In our last video, for the details, you can refer to our last video on the synthesis of thyroid hormones. Now, what happens in this thyroid follicle? If you take the section of this, endoplasmic reticulum by releasing the thyroglobulin through exocytosis mechanism into the lumen. This thyroglobulin, at the same time, here sodium iodide's importers will release the iodide through the pendrene, and this iodide will get converted into the iodine, and this iodine and thyroglobulin by combining or by the process iodination, they will enter the cell through endocytosis. In between the various process, the like conjugation will occur and tyrosyl residues will get connected to each other, and once the proteolysis, proteolysis or such as the enzyme called as proteases will split this residue and release the T3 and T4 into the bloodstream to the MCT. So, when it comes to secretion, as I told you earlier, hypothalamus is controlling the master gland called as pituitary gland through various mechanisms, and this pituitary gland, now see, this hypothalamus will release and inhibit the hormone that regulate the secretion of anterior pituitary hormone. Like from the hypothalamus, when it is confined to the secretion of thyroid hormones, hypothalamus will release TRH, and TRH will send the signal to pituitary. Pituitary will release TSH, and TSH will be released into the bloodstream. It will attach on the receptors which are present on the thyroid gland, and this TSH will in turn stimulate thyroid gland to secrete the thyroxine and triiodothyronine. This thyrotropin releasing hormone TRH in hypothalamus, thyroid stimulating hormone TSH in pituitary, and T3 and T4 from thyroid gland. So, these three connections we are going to see now through the diagram. Now, see, this first step, what happens, as we have seen in this image, that hypothalamus is the first starting point. So, what happens? Hypothalamus, the neurosecretory neurons which are present in the hypothalamus or neurosecretory cells will produce. They will secrete the TRH, that is thyrotropin releasing hormone, and these neurosecretory neurons by secreting TRH, this thyrotropin, T stands for thyrotropin, R stands for releasing, H stands for hormone. This TRH will be released and it travels to the anterior pituitary through the axon terminal. Now these neurosecretory neurons, this TRH will reach to the anterior pituitary through axon terminal. That means TRH will travel through that neuronal cell. It will reach to the axon terminal and it goes to the anterior pituitary. So, this hypothalamus is acting as the link between nervous system and endocrine system. So, how it is so? See, here in this, you can see this hypothalamus. This all process is by hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis, that is hypophyseal portal system. This hypophyseal portal system is acting as the bridge between hypothalamus and pituitary. Through hypophyseal portal system, that is hypothalamic pituitary axis, it will act on that axis, and this hypothalamus, by synthesizing and secreting the TRH, that is thyrotropin releasing hormone, it will reach to the anterior pituitary through the hypophyseal portal system along the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. And by reaching to the through the axon terminal, by reaching to the anterior pituitary through hypophyseal portal system, it will come to endocrine receptors. Now, this TRH will bind to the endocrine receptors, not where, which are present on the pituitary. So, pituitary gland space, it will bind to various receptors present, that is endocrine receptors, and it will stimulate the cells, pituitary cells, to secrete thyroid stimulating hormone. Now, this pituitary gland will secrete TSH, the abbreviated form of thyroid stimulating hormone, and this TSH, once released from the anterior pituitary, it will come into the bloodstream. Once it is there into the environment, this TSH will attach on the receptors which are present on the endocrine gland, as you can see here. So these will attach on the thyroid receptors which are present on the thyroid follicular cells, and these thyroid receptors, by attaching to these thyroid receptors, this TSH will stimulate the synthesis of thyroid hormones. So this was the process. Hypothalamus, through the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis, it will reach to the pituitary gland. TRH, this TRH will stimulate pituitary to release TSH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone. Thyroid stimulating hormone in turn will be attached to the thyroid receptors which are present on the thyroid follicular cells. These will again in turn get stimulated to secrete T4 and T3. Now T4, which is secreted, is 80% and T3 is 20%, but T3 is the active form. So first it should get converted into this T4, which is there in the extra quantity or large quantity, 80%, and this is 20%. So this T4 is first supposed to get converted into T3, and this T3 will have the actions on various target tissues, like all over the body it acts actually thyroid hormones, but the major organs like heart, liver, bone, CNS, etc., these will show the action. Now this feedback mechanism is also there, as you can see here, negative feedback, and which is sent to the pituitary gland as well as hypothalamus. So what happens here, we will see in the feedback loop of thyroid hormones. So what is positive feedback, what is negative feedback, these things we will cover in our next video. What happens to the when it comes to the excess thyroid hormone secretion, what happens when there is a lower or when there is deficient quantities of thyroid hormones, sufficient quantity thyroid hormones are not there, then how the signals will be sent, the excess quantity of thyroid hormones when they are there, then how the signals will be sent to the hypothalamus, and how hypothalamus will act. All these things we are going to cover in the feedback loop mechanism of thyroid hormones. With this, we finish with the secretion of thyroid hormones. Thank you.